It is the season of the Advent. We remember the expectation of the first coming of the Anointed One, the promise of God, the Messiah, the Christ. As we remember His coming as that baby in the manger, we look to the future of His coming again as King of Kings. Just for a moment, put yourself in the place of a young mother. She has just given birth to her firstborn. She knew the words of the prophets that were concerning the one who would be the salvation of Israel. She remembered the words spoken to her by Gabriel. He will be great and will be called the Son of the Most High. The Lord God will give him the throne of his father David. That night, in a stable, she saw men bow at his feet in worship. But you know, the reality is that Mary did not know everything we know. She did not know the wonders he would perform, the people he would touch and heal and deliver, the way he would care for the poor and the outcast, the stories he would tell, the truth he would teach, or the sacrifice he would one day make. She simply held Jesus, and she loved him as she pondered what others were saying. She pondered it in her heart.
Did you know that your baby boy would save our sons and daughters? Did you know that your baby boy has come to make you new? This child that you've delivered will soon deliver. You know that your baby boy will give sight to a blind man. Mary, did you know that your baby boy would calm a storm with his hand? Did you know that your baby boy is head where angels trod? When you kiss your little baby, kiss the face of God. The blind will see, the deaf will hear, the dead will live again. The lame will leap, the dumb will speak, the praises of the great time.
was a night like any other night, except for that angel. Ain't seen nothing like it before or since. Us shepherds, we don't get a lot of excitement out there on the pasture. But that angel, it was so bright, so beautiful. I know what you're thinking. You're thinking, Sam, you've been out in that pasture just a little bit too long. And you'd be correct. But that all changed when that angel came right up to us. And the angel said, "Don't be afraid." I was like, "Too late." And then the angel said, no, I wrote it down. I need to get this right. Hold on. Okay. The angel said, that's my grocery list. Then the angel said, "I have good news of a great joy that shall be for all the people. For unto you is born this day in the city of David a Savior, which is Christ the Lord." And then the angel said, "He's lying in a manger, wrapped in cloth. Go find him." Okie dokie. So we're all sitting around, and then one of the shepherds, I think it was Steve, he's like, "Hey, what are we doing? Let's get out of here. Let's go to Bethlehem." So we hightailed it out of there, and we found that beautiful baby. I'll tell you, I was a different man after that. God chose me. And nobody's ever chosen me for anything. I'll never forget what that angel said, though. The angel said, "I bring good news to all people." That means you too.
Beautiful star of Bethlehem.
into the land of perfect day.
Beautiful star of Bethlehem, shine on.
Beautiful star.
Thank you. they were there, the time came for the baby to be born. And she gave birth to her firstborn, a son. She wrapped him in cloths and she laid him in a manger because there was no room for them in the inn. God had this messy plan, a plan to save the world. And to do that, he was going to send his son. Where does the God of the universe send his son? Where does the King of Kings and Lord of Lords come? To a barn, a stable, a manger, of all places. Certainly no place fit for a king. But then again, this wasn't any ordinary king. When I say it was messy, I mean messy. It was a barn, a stable, right? So you've got animals and animal stuff, manure, mud, a pitiful place for people, much less a place for the King of Kings to be born. Why would God do that? Well, I can't tell you for sure, because Isaiah explains to us that his thoughts are not our thoughts and his ways are not our ways. But that same prophet, 400 years before Jesus was born, said, "All we like sheep have gone astray, each of us to our own way, and that he has laid our iniquities on him." You see, Jesus came to a messy place. Oh, yeah, a barn, a manger, that's messy. But he came to a messy world. Why? Because the shepherd was coming to take care of the sheep, to prepare a way for them to go home. That's what a shepherd does. He lives where the sheep are. He sleeps where they sleep. He eats where they eat. It got Jesus in trouble. Why did Jesus eat with sinners? Because that's what the shepherd does. An angel appeared to the shepherds in the field and said, "This will be a sign to you. You will find the babe wrapped in cloths and laying in a manger." A sign. You ever wondered what that sign was? A sign for what? Maybe a sign that Jesus is accessible to everyone. A sign that the God who owns the cattle on a thousand hills can relate to a homeless person. Because Jesus never had a home, never had a place to rest his head. Maybe it was a sign that God would have nothing to do with the social status of mankind. A sign that he detests the splendor of humans, because it's not worthy of him. But it was a sign for us that we should follow suit. In fact, the Apostle Paul later on would write, we should have the same attitude as Christ Jesus. Although he was the very nature God, did not consider equality with God something to be grasped, but that he made himself nothing, becoming a servant, being made in human likeness. A servant. You see, being a servant is messy. And Jesus set this incredible example for us. I mean, he got down on his knees and he washed feet. The God of the universe, the God who deserved the best of everything, got on his knees. He's the God who came to the world and was laid in a manger, a feed trough of all places. Why such a messy place? Because he was following a messy plan. So needless to say, that very first Christmas was dirty. It was grimy. It was filthy. But thank God it was. Because without it, what a mess we'd be in.
Come and worship, worship Christ the King. the one of whom you read, and as he spoke to men that day, the heavenly host around the throne joined in to say, glory to God in the highest, peace on earth and goodwill to men. Heavenly angels announced his arrival in the little town of Bethlehem. Hallelujah to the Lord, sing holy. He was born to save the world from sin. Glory to God in the highest glory. Hallelujah to the Lord, amen. Glory to God in the highest, peace on earth and goodwill to men. Heavenly angels announced his arrival in the little town of Bethlehem. Hallelujah to the Lord, sing holy. He was born to save the world from sin. Glory to God in the highest glory. Hallelujah to the Lord, amen.
Come and hear the Christmas story. It's native to nativities and takes the cross over a Christmas tree. It's the story of how God became flesh and how Christ changed history. Deity didn't descend as royalty, but was born in a barn like a poor man's donkey. Gave up the throne of heaven for the livestock's lunch tray. Traded the worship of heavenly cherubim for shepherds' earthly praise. This is the incarnation celebration. A story of defeat, poverty, and degradation. A tale that lacks the trappings of our holiday's glorification. It's an anecdote of murder, homelessness, and subjugation. The legacy of Jesus doesn't fit in a gift box. He hung on a tree while we hang up our gift socks, sat in a trough as we sit on the lap of Santa Claus. Come and hear the Christmas story. Man needed God, so God made an outpouring, poured eternity into the earthly, became a spotless lamb by living perfectly. Humanity was unholy and had wholly earned a holy wrath, so they slaughtered oxen and burned up calves to bear the justice of their aftermath. But God was not satisfied by that. His unconditional forgiveness required an unconventional path. He was not an angry God that needed to be appeased, but he was a righteous God who longed to save you and save me. And he would be. This is the Christmas story, a tradition untold by all other religions, that God hears our prayers and became flesh just to listen. Let us celebrate when God came to marry his bride. Celebrate the start of why we are called Christians. Let us all say, Merry Christmas.
Spirit, or where can I flee from your presence? If I ascend to heaven, you are there. If I make my bed in Sheol, behold, you are there. And And Jesus has told us, "For where two or three have gathered together in my name, I am there in their midst." Yes, beloved, he is here. He is with us now. A savior from our sin, a deliverer from our bondage, a shelter from our shame, our hope of heaven. This is our season to rejoice. Unto us a Savior is born. Our God in heaven has met our deepest longings. His answer, Jesus, only Jesus.
Who can save us from our
May you be filled with the wonder of Mary, the obedience of Joseph, the joy of the angels, the eagerness of the shepherds, the determination of the Magi, and the peace of the Christ child. May Almighty God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit bless you now and forever. And in that blessing, may you find peace. And peace is spelled J-E-S-U-S. Brother Brian.
I'd like to share the book of Luke with you in an exchange of Mary and the angel Gabriel. And in Nazareth, as we know, that Gabriel came before Mary and proclaimed to her that you're going to bear the child of God. And in that, she was didn't understand, and he goes and explains what the purpose for this is. And in that exchange, she comes before him in their last moments of conversation. It says in chapter 1, verse 37, she says, "For nothing will be impossible with God." And Mary said, "Behold, I am the servant of the Lord. Let it be to me according to your word." And the angel departed from her. And then she goes and she visits her relatives, and she's in exchange with Elizabeth, and she tells of the great news that has been proclaimed to her. And even the babe, who we know would be John the Baptist, leaps in the womb, and Elizabeth is filled with the Holy Spirit at the impact of the good news that's been proclaimed of the hope of Christ, who would come through a teenage girl named Mary. And through this young lady, who was probably scared to death, probably still didn't really understand the magnitude of what was fixing to happen, the culture meant that she would be probably renounced from her community, even facing execution quite possibly. Much sacrifice that she was fixing to have to embark upon for God to be able to create his work and his great movement for the world through a young lady. And her response was, "Behold, I am the servant of the Lord. Let it be to me according to your word." And she's talking to Elizabeth, and she says here in verse 46, she cries out, "My soul magnifies the Lord, and my spirit rejoices in God my Savior, for he has looked on the humble estate of his servant. For behold, now on all generations will call me blessed. For he who is mighty, he has done great things for me, and holy is his name. And his mercy is for those who fear him from generation to generation." This was a young girl. She was not of great prominence. She was not some great woman in high courts and of great money and of great wealth. She was a teenage girl who was perfect for God. She was humble and she was obedient, and she was willing to sacrifice whatever it took for God to be able to come. Her exchange was, "Behold, I'm your humble servant. I've come to be obedient to your word." And I want to say to you that the hope of God is Jesus Christ has been exclaimed tonight. And tonight, I want to say to you that if you do not know Jesus, then there would be no greater way to celebrate Christmas this Christmas season than for you to not only be able to talk about it and to be able to be with family and just go through the motions of Christmas, but to really experience Christmas for the first time in your life by accepting Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior. And all it takes is for you to take that act of faith, just like Mary did, and to say, "Lord, I know that you have a plan and a will for me, and his plan is to save you. He came into this world so that everyone in this house of worship tonight and every breathing human being in this world could have an opportunity to hear the gospel and to receive Jesus Christ as the Lord and Savior. That's why Jesus came, so that we would have hope tonight. So that we would not come into this place just to sing songs, just to fellowship and hang out. No, we can do that in any other place, really. We can go to a concert and sing songs. but tonight that we could come and worship the one true living God, the one Savior who came as a babe wrapped in swaddling clothes, lying in a manger. And His name was Jesus. And tonight, if you don't know Him, He came for you. He loves you more than anything. And the beautiful part of the gospel story is that a God would humble Himself and would empty Himself to come and send His Son, Jesus Christ, into this world. And His Son would leave the portals of a holy heaven to come and live into a sinful, dark world that we're living in, because He loves us. Tonight, I want to say to you that I hope that as you are a believer, and I hope that that reality is for you tonight, and if it is, we can learn so much from Mary. Have thine own way. I want to be a servant to you. Father, whatever the cost, whatever the sacrifice it means, Lord, work through me. Use me. Father, I'm willing to give it all away because I believe and I know in my heart and in my life that you're so much greater than anything in this world. Tonight, I hope you know Christ. Tonight, I hope you're living in the love relationship that Christ so richly came for you. And if you haven't, please give your heart to Jesus tonight. Tonight, we're going to close out in a benediction from our choir. And so, if you have anything laying upon your heart tonight, please talk to us, okay? Pull us to the side. We'd love to speak with you and talk to you more about salvation through Jesus.